Okay, the last section here to deal with circles, and here we kind of focus on putting circles in the coordinate plane. And the idea here is if we're all, if I give you guys a circle to graph, and you think about what information would you need in order to graph that circle, and if I gave everybody the same information, what would I need to give them so that everybody draws exactly the same thing? So it kind of goes back to how we write an equation for a line. If you want to write the equation for a line, it's really cool if I can give you a point and a slope, right? Or at least like the slope and the y-intercept. And you plug it into y equals mx plus b, right? The slope goes there, the y-intercept goes there. So if I said, hey, the slope is 1/2 and the y-intercept is like 0.5, then you go, okay, the 5 goes in there for b, the slope goes in there for 1/2, so it's that equation is 1/2 x plus 5. And everybody, we know how to graph that. We go to 5 on the y-axis and then use a slope of up 1 and over 2, so something like that. All right, and we'd all graph the same line. So let's talk about how we can do the same thing with circles. And then ultimately what we figure out is really I need two things for the circle. Like if I was, gave you a compass and some graph paper and I wanted us to all graph the same thing, we would need you need to know where to put the center of the circle. That's the starting point. Where do I put my compass to begin with? And then what radius do you want? So you need a center and a radius. So if we check this out, and you think about also the equation of a line. This equation of a line just gives you a set of points that are all on this line together. So there's an x and a y that go together and fit into that equation to give you the line. So it's kind of the same thing with a circle. This equation for a circle describes for us what values of x and y would give me coordinates that form a circle. And ultimately, it kind of comes from something that we call the distance formula. Like, how do I describe, if I have my center point, how do I describe the location of every single point on this circle? And they can all be found kind of by using the same method of saying this. They all have to be a radius length away. But how do we define, or how do we find distances in the coordinate plane? We use the distance formula, which essentially is based on the Pythagorean theorem. So it's no different with circles. Every point on this circle, right, no matter where I put it, unless it's like, vertical from it or below it, up above it or below it, or to the left and right to make a horizontal line, any other point I can create some right triangles to find that distance. And that's going to involve the Pythagorean theorem. So every point is a certain distance away from the center point. So let's just take this random point here, this x and this y, the point P. Again, it's the radius length away. The circle centered at this point, which I'm just labeling H and K so that this can represent any circle. And let's talk about how we can find, how we can describe this point and how it relates to how it's a radius length away from the center CK. So if I look at this right triangle that we created, so I'll just pick this point and I said, okay, I have to go over to the right this much from the center and I have to go up that much from the center in order to be that radius length away from the circle. So again, from the center, sorry. I'm going to base this on the Pythagorean theorem, right, because that is a right triangle. And so what I can put in here is, I know that CA squared, that's one of the legs, plus AP squared has to equal CP squared. Well, CP is the radius, and then CA, how can I describe that length of CA? Well, CA is just the difference, right? If I'm looking at the x-axis, right, this distance here, it's going from H out to x, right? Because that's the x coordinate there. So what's the length of that segment there? Well, it's going to be the absolute value of x minus h. Or the way we learned it with the distance formula, it was x2 minus x1. So it's kind of the same thing here. I know that distance then is x minus h. Now, I put the absolute value because we always want it to be positive, but since it's getting squared right here, it's going to be positive anyway, so we just go and put in parentheses as x minus h. And we can do the same thing with the with this side PA or AP. It's going from, right, y, like the vertical height of y, down to this where the center is at. Its vertical height is k, or it's at k on the y-axis. So again, what's the length of that side right there? Well, it's going to be y minus k. Again, kind of like we had y2 minus y1 when we looked at the distance formula. So again, I put that in parentheses. It's y minus k squared. Okay, so just by using the Pythagorean theorem, right, and then realizing how to calculate these lengths of each of the legs, we can write an equation. That's what this is. This is an equation that could give us any point on that circle as long as we have the center, h, k, and as long as we know the radius. Okay, I could plug in for the I could plug in for the center h and k. I could plug in for the radius r, and that will give us an equation where, give me an x value, I could find the y value that goes with it, or vice versa, give me the y value, I can find you the x value that goes with it, and that gives us all the points on that circle. Right. So again, Pythagorean theorem, huge deal. We've been using it all semester. Here it is again, helping us write the standard form for the equation of a circle, which is defined right here. So again, the nice thing to know, or the easiest way that we'd have these problems work out for us, is if they give us the center and the radius, because we've now got this general form that we can plug it into. So all we're plugging in for is h and k and r. Right? Our equations, just like for lines, we're going to keep the x in there, we're going to keep the y in there, right? Because remember how we had y equals mx plus b? Nothing's really going in there for the x and the y. We're just plugging in for the two slope and intercept values. It's kind of the same thing here. We're going to leave that x and that y in the problem. So all of our equations of a circle should look something like, x plus something in parentheses squared. I'm making some numbers up. Y plus 3 squared, or it could be minus. And then you've got some number that's getting squared over here, like 36, right? That's 6 squared. So that's kind of what we're all going to work on here. This is basically the most easy question ever, as long as you can remember this general form for the equation. And again, that's why we go back to showing you where it comes from. Hopefully you can remember that this general form of equation of a circle, or the standard form there, just comes from a squared plus b squared equals c squared. Just the radius is going to go in for c, and then you're getting a and b from that x minus h and y minus k. That's again the lengths of our sides of that right triangle. So, am I even recording? Oh no. Sorry about that. I didn't see my little recording button up there, so I was like, "Am I recording?" And then my friend Alexa just went off. If I shut that down, it would help. Okay. Anyway, back to this, right? We're gonna plug this information into that formula up there. So this is my h, that's my k, that's coming in as the center, and obviously that's the radius r. So it's gonna be x minus, my h is negative 2. So x minus h squared plus y minus k, plugging in 5 for k, equals the radius, which is 3. And again, don't forget your powers of 2 there, because again, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. So now I just have to simplify a few of these things like this. We can drop the parentheses there and change that to a negative, and a negative makes a plus. So x plus 2 squared plus y minus 5 squared equals 9. So that is our equation of the circle. This was kind of the same thing. Plugging that in for h, plugging that in for k, plugging that in for r. So x minus 4 squared plus y minus negative 1 squared equals square root of 5 squared. Right, again, coming from the general form for the, or sorry, the standard form of the equation of a circle. So simplify this in parentheses there. That's just x minus 4, and that's y plus 1. And then here, when you raise a radical, or at least when you raise a square root by the power of 2, it just cancels out that radical. So there you go. If I give you the center and I give you the radius, you should be able to write this equation pretty quickly. Now, here's another question, just kind of in general. Saying, suppose the circle with the equation here is translated by, translated, remember, means it just, we just slide it around. So we've moved it to the right 3 and then down 1. We're supposed to think about how that changes the circle. Is it going to have an effect on the radius if it's a translation? No, translations are rigid motions that keep the circles the same. So the radius doesn't change. But the center is going to change. Let's see what the center does. So where this was centered at, remember it's x minus h squared plus y minus k squared. So our center was at, because this is negative, I'm going to change the signs. It was centered at, that's positive 2, negative 4, right? As I pull these out of here, I've got to change the signs because it's minus h and minus k. So that's going to move to x plus 3 means I'm adding 3 to the x values, and then I'm supposed to subtract 1 from the y values. So that equation then becomes, plug it back in, x minus 5 squared plus y minus a minus 5 makes it plus 5 squared. The radius, though, does not change. So the whole circle is going to move. As far as the equation is concerned, though, I really only care about the center because that's what I'm plugging in. The radius isn't going to change. Just two quick examples here. If you want to pause the video and try these out, I'm going to write the answer down. They're going to pop up in just a second. So pause it, work these out, and then check your answer. Okay, so there you go. There's those two answers. Again, you're just plugging it into the general form. X minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals the radius squared. Okay, so you can should be able to go backwards too. If I'm given the graph, or actually go back real quick, I should be able to take this information and graph the circle. Or if I was given the equation, I could get that information and graph the circle. You should also be able to go backwards and say, if you give me the graph, we can write the equation. Again, I'm just looking for what I need to plug into x minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared. So again, I just need to find the center and figure out the radius, and then it's going to get plugged into that. So if you look at this first circle, hey, where's that center at? I believe that's at 1, negative 2. Right, there's the center. The radius, super easy to get with a circle in the coordinate plane. You just count either vertically or horizontally. In that case, it's 2. So the radius is 2. The center is at 1, 2. So just plug it in. X minus 1 squared plus y minus a negative 2 makes it plus 2 squared equals the radius is 2. 2 squared is 4. Okay. This one looks like it's centered right there. Okay. So that's centered at the point, 1, 2, negative 1. And then the radius, if I count out this way, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Or down, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That can also kind of help me make sure I'm in the middle. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yep. So the radius is 5. So I'll plug this in. X minus 2 squared plus y minus a negative 1 makes it plus 1 squared equals 5 squared is 25. Now, again, you may want to pause the video for a second and then try to work out this next one real quick. And then I'll show you the answer. Okay, so pause, work this one out, and then here's my answer. This one looks like it's centered about there. That's at the point negative 1, 1. And then it's got a radius of 1, 2, 3, 4. So again, we're just plugging this in. X minus a negative 1 makes it plus 1 squared plus y minus a positive 1. So y minus 1 squared equals 4 squared is 16. Don't forget to square that radius when you put that number out there. I guarantee you on a multiple choice test that would have out there x plus 1 squared plus y minus 1 squared equals 4 because people often forget to square that radius. So, next thing we need to look at is this. Remember how with lines, sometimes we're given an equation and we're asked to graph it. But we need to put it in slope-intercept form first because I can easily graph it that way. I can find the y-intercept and then I can graph it. So for example, if it was like 2x plus 3y minus 4 is equal to 0. Let's say that's the equation. I don't like that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, I want to turn it into y equals mx plus b. So it means I need to get the y totally by itself. So first I'm going to move that 4 to the other side by addition. We're going to add 4 to both sides. Then we're going to subtract the 2x from both sides. So that becomes negative 2x plus 4. Then I want that y all alone, so I'll divide everything by 3. My final answer then is negative 2/3 x plus 4 over 3. So now I know that's my y-intercept. I know that's my slope. I can now graph the line. So we're gonna try again with circles to do kind of the same thing. If I want to graph a circle and I'm given this random equation that looks something like that, nothing like what I need it to, I need to do a bunch of algebra to make it look the way I want, which is in standard form. So I want to make all these circle equations look something like this. And that way when I have that, I can pull out the radius, I can pull out the center at H and K, right? So that's what we're going to have to do. So we have to do this thing that we call completing the square, right? Because essentially when you look at this, this is a term that's getting squared. So that's essentially a perfect square. This is also a perfect square. That's also a perfect square. Not to say that the radius has to be a perfect square, but whatever we're putting over there is something that's getting squared, so that answer is a perfect square. So if you look at these equations, right, I actually have two squares that I'm going to have to complete because I want this with the x values to somehow factor into something that I can turn into this, right? And the same thing with the y's. I want to turn that into y minus k squared. And kind of the cool thing about this is that equations are neat. I can add stuff to it if I need to make it look the way I want. I just have to make sure whatever I add or subtract or multiply or divide, I do it to both sides of that equation. So here, let's look at that x squared minus 4x. I want to turn that into what we call a perfect square trinomial. I want some term to go, I'm going to add to it, I want it to go in that parentheses so that I can factor it into x minus something or x plus something squared. Okay? And this can sometimes be a little confusing, but it's easy if you remember what you're supposed to do. All you have to do is take that middle term, divide it by 2, and bring the sign with it. So that's a negative 4. So I'll take negative 4 divided by 2, and basically I put it in that parentheses there where it's going to get squared. So the reason I do that is if I work that out or simplify that, I get x squared minus 4x plus negative 4 over 2 is negative 2. Negative 2 squared is 4, right? So this just turns into a 4. The reason that's nice is because I can factor this, okay? Remember what we could do? We look at factors of 4 that add up to negative 4, which will be a 2, negative 2, and a negative 2. That's what that factors into, which what's negative 2 times negative, or sorry, what's x minus 2 times x minus 2? Well, that just turns into x minus 2 squared. So what I did there by adding this was I completed that square. And then we need to do the same thing with the y's. So I've got this y squared plus 2y. I need to add something to that in order to complete that square. Again, I just take that middle term and divide it by 2 and put it in that parentheses there that's getting squared. So 2 over 2 squared is just 1. So I get y squared plus 2y plus 1. And then again, this right here is a trinomial that will factor. Right? What are factors of 1 that will add up to 2? Well, it's just 1 times 1, and then 1 plus 1 is 2. So this becomes y plus 1 times y plus 1. So in the end, I get, again, that just becomes y plus 1 squared. Now, we can't forget, we've done some stuff here to the left side of the equation. But whatever we did to the left side, we also need to add to the right. So we've got to take this, right, which essentially we turned into the 4, right? We got to take that 4 and this right here we added, which turned into a 1. We got to take that positive 4 and positive 1. We also have to add it to the other side of this equation, right? So we got to add plus 4 and plus 1. Well, what's 20 plus 4 plus 1? That gives us 25, right? So this now looks like our equation for a circle. And so I know that then the center, if I pull that out, is at positive 2, negative 1. So it's centered at 2, negative 1. And I know the radius is the square root of this number, right? Because this is, remember how that's r squared? So then the radius is the square root of 25, which is 5. So to graph that circle, go to that point, I go over 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right, if I'm doing this by hand, I'd probably just do like go over 5, go up 5, go to the left 5, go down 5, then try to freehand it. If you have a compass, you just go to that point, open up your circle to that radius. Let's make it the right color. There you go. Then you can graph it, right? It's got a circle that's got a radius of 5, centered at negative 2, 1. Right, so let's see that again. I know that's a little bit confusing. And actually, I'm going to make it a little bit easier because we're going to skip that step because we know it's going to end up here anyway because we're completing the square. So here, take that x squared plus 6x. We're going to add something in parentheses that gets squared to make it a perfect square. Again, we're just going to take that middle term and divide it by 2. Right, so that's just 6 over 2, which is 3. Matter of fact, we're just going to go ahead and say, hey, I know by the way I'm setting it up, all this is going to turn into this anyway. So really all that happens is I take that x, right, and then then I take this term right here. It's positive because I'm using that symbol. 6 over 2 is 3. So that's how that's going to end up. Do the same thing with the y's. I got y squared minus 4y. What am I going to add to both sides? I'm going to add that negative 4 over 2 squared. Take that middle term, divide it by 2, and square it. And so when I bring this down, it just becomes y. And then that inside that parentheses is a minus 2, right? Negative 4 divided by 2 is negative 2. And then I just need to figure out what's on the other side of the equation, which there was a, oh, there was a 4 right here that I forgot to do something with, right? I actually need to move that to the other side. And actually, in hindsight, I probably could go back and say, hey, this is kind of already a perfect square, but it's okay. So if we move that to the other side, it becomes negative 4. So what did we add to these two equations, or to these two squares? We added 3 squared, and we added 2 squared. Right? So plus 3 squared, which is 9, plus 2 squared, which is 4. Those cancel out. I just end up with 9 over here. So I know that my radius then is 3 because it's the square root of that. And I know that the center is at negative 3, 2. So go to negative 3, go up to 2, and it's got a radius of 1, 2, 3. So take my compass there. And I'm going to have trouble getting this lined up, so let's see. There you go. And then I can graph the circle, radius of 3. Okay. So if you're given an equation not quite in standard form for the equation of a circle, you just have to put it in that form by completing the square. Now, this question deals with something else. Like, if I want to know if a point is on the equation of a, or is on a circle, I need to know, does that x and that y fit into the equation? So I need to figure out, in this case, the equation of the circle. Thankfully, it's centered at the origin, so I know that my h and k is just 0, 0. And then it's got the point in it, so if I graphed it, it's like, it's centered here. It's got the point negative 4, 0 in it. It's like on the circle. So if that's the case, what is the radius? Because I need the radius and the center to plug into my standard form. Right? Well, the radius, if it's going from 0 out to negative 4, that's a radius of 4. If this went somewhere else, like if this was another random point, like say that was a 6 or a 7 or something, then you have to use the distance formula to figure out that radius. But that's what you need, again, to write the equation. You need the radius. This one would just happen to be really easy to find. So what's my equation for the circle? What's x minus 0 squared plus y minus 0 squared is equal to 4 squared. Now this one's kind of unique because it's centered at the origin. Those zeros I don't really have to worry about. It just turns into x squared plus y squared equals 16. So then the question is, does this point fit into this equation? Right? Because if it does, it's on the circle. If it doesn't, it's not. So we plug in the 3 for the x. We plug in the square root of 7 for the y. Is that equal to 16? Well, this becomes 9, right? 3 squared is 9. When I square 7 squared, I get 7. So is 9 plus 7 equal to 16? It is, right? So this one is on the circle. So, again, the process here is find the center, figure out the radius by doing, sometimes you have to do distance formula. In this case, it was nice, I just had to count the units. But you find the center and the radius, just like we were doing previously. Write the equation for that circle, right? Get it worked out, simplify it as much as you can. and then plug the point that they give you in as the x and the y and see if the equation stays balanced. Okay, so I hope that made sense. Kind of running out of time, so we're going to have to stop there. Go and do those practice problems on HRW or whatever worksheet I give you, and then hopefully it works out for you. Let me know if you have any questions.